Hello, this is Dr. Gary Hawkins with the University of Georgia Crop and Soil Science Department and UGA Extension. Today we will be demonstrating how to use the Enviroscape Watershed model. Funding for this video has been in part from Georgia's EPD 319 program. Today we're going to focus on a few ways to use the Enviroscape Watershed model. The model will be used to explain different sources of pollution and practices to reduce pollution as it relates to agriculture. What we will show is just an example of what can be discussed with the model. For more ideas, check your manual, which has some other hints and ways to use the model. As you can see, we have the model set up with roads in place. This is our animal waste lagoon. We've got our cows in the pasture. We've got our houses set up and we've got our tractor there in the field. To show how soil moves, the first thing you'd want to do is get your cocoa or some powdered drink mix to represent soil. Sprinkle some of this onto the field portion of the model to represent the loose soil that is in the field. The next thing we do is put some fertilizer on to help grow our food and fiber. This can be a different colored drink mix. I have found red, green, or purple works best. You can then discuss the application of fertilizer, pesticide, or herbicides by using different colored drink mixes. Typically, I just use the same drink mix so we don't have too many colors mixing into our lake a little later. As we talk about putting the soil and putting fertilizer out, you can also discuss how the manure in some cases, if available, can actually be used as well. Some of this liquid can be put on the field, and you can discuss why manure is a very good organic fertilizer source. The next thing we talk about is what happens when we receive rainfall. We'll spray a little water on the model. When raindrops hit unprotected soil, the first stage of erosion begins. This is called splash erosion. As you can see in this picture, the force of raindrop causes soil to be dislodged, where it then is able to move more easily. As more rain falls, the water starts puddling. That puddling allows the applied fertilizer to dissolve. This puddling doesn't move any soil around, and it also allows the water, fertilizer, and pesticide to actually infiltrate the soil and help grow crops. By adding more water, you can mimic a large storm. At this point, you can start to see the fertilizer, soil, and pesticides start to run into our lake and our rivers. This is typically what would be seen in a clean tilled or conventionally tilled field. As the water starts to move downhill, we enter the next phase of erosion. These are sheet, reel, and gully erosion. Sheet erosion typically occurs in short distances at the beginning of water movement. Sheet erosion moves the soil that was dislodged by splash erosion. The next stage of erosion is reel erosion. Reel erosion is the formation of small eroded channels having a depth easily fixed with tillage, and they don't have any specific length. The last phase of erosion is gully erosion. Gullies are defined as eroded trench with a depth unable to be fixed with tillage. As can be seen here, gullies can be quite deep. As we continue to add rain to the model, you can see how the water starts moving downhill into our lakes, rivers, or streams. This movement of water also can carry with it soil, fertilizer, pesticides, and manure. As this water enters the lake here in the model, you can see the movement of soil, fertilizer, and pesticides throughout the lake. As the water slows down in the lake, the soil settles out. This is a process of deposition and can cause the depth of the lake to drastically be lowered over time. The movement of soil and then the deposition as sediment is one of the largest forms of pollution from agriculture. As the soil settles, it has the potential to cover lake, river, and stream bottoms, causing the plant and animal life to die. The fertilizers and pesticides that run off the land into the water are also pollutants that can cause excessive plant growth and potentially plant or animal kills. Another potential source of pollution from farms is animals. If you notice on the model, there are no fences around these animals. With no fences, the animals have access to the creek at pretty much any location. This allows them to get in and out of the creek wherever they would like. If we had trees on the creek banks, such as a riparian area, they would tend to stay in the shaded areas longer and have higher potential of polluting the creek. By allowing the animals easy access to the creek, they can cause increased erosion on the banks as a result of vegetation removal. In addition to sediment, if the animals are allowed to spend long periods of time in the creek, they will urinate or defecate in the creek, causing more water pollution problems. To show this on the model, some of the cocoa or colored drink mix can be sprinkled on the banks adjacent to the pasture area and then water sprayed on to simulate rainfall. the sediment, urine, and feces then can move further downstream into the pond or lake. These are some of the sources of pollution from our agricultural fields and animal areas adjacent to the creeks. Now that the sources of pollution have been discussed for both the fields and the animal areas, we'll leave the model set up and talk about some of the best management practices, or sometimes called BMPs, that can be used on the land to hopefully reduce and stop the movement of pollutants off-site. For more information about BMPs, you can see your local county extension agent, your local NRCS professional, or your local soil and water conservation district personnel here in Georgia to show some of the BMPs that can be used. And this is not a complete list. We'll start with our cropland. As you can see, with the water is just puddled from when we were eroded the field earlier. One of the ways, and this is just one of the many different ways you can put BMPs on the site, is by using some of the clay in your model kit. Model a little bit of clay, which you can then put around the end of the field here. What this will do is actually make a small dam. The small dam on a working farm would cause the formation of a small wetland just upstream of your pond, right on the end of your field. As it rains, the dam will catch the water to form a small wetland. As you can see here, some of the water is getting past the dam, but as you set up your model, you can better form the clay to stop water flow under the dam. The small wetland will allow you to initially catch any water drained from the field and allow you to discuss how wetlands are used as a means to provide some treatment of the water prior to release into the pond. This treatment could consist of sedimentation of soil and removal of nutrients through plant uptake or denitrification process. Another way to reduce sediment and nutrient movement off-site is through the use of vegetation in areas where water flows. In your kit, there are some small felt strips. You can take the back off of the strips and use them as filter strips, which would be placed here at the end of the field. These strips are called vegetative filters. This should work the same way as the wetland dam. It would stop the liquid from flowing into the pond, or at least slow it down to the point where the soil settles out, and then you can further discuss how vegetative filters work. The grasses and the roots of the trees and the grass in the filter strip take up the nitrogen, slow the water down enough so that deposition can occur, and reduce the amount of pollution moving into the pond. Another thing you can talk about as you're looking at the cropland itself is residue management, as one of the NRCS practices or conservation tillage. Conservation tillage allows the farmer to grow rye or wheat or another cover crop during the winter time on the bare land. Then in the spring, a few weeks prior to planting, farmers will kill the winter cover. Killing the winter cover allows the soil to store some water for planting the summer crop, but also provides a mat of residue or a residue cover. This mulch is not exactly like, but is similar to the pine straw or mulch we put in our flower beds. The purpose of this residue or mulch on the ground is to help increase water retention, help water infiltration, decrease water runoff, build organic matter in the soil, build a living community in that soil, and a multitude of other benefits. If you want to know more about conservation tillage or other best management practices for cropland itself, see your local extension agents, your local NRCS personnel, or your local soil and water conservation district personnel. Those are some of your cropland type BMPs we can use. Like I said earlier, there are many more that can be discussed using the items in the kit. For the animal BMPs, again, you can see here, we just have animals roaming free. Typically, there would be a fence here. We left a fence off in this case just for clarity, but of course, to keep the animals confined to the pasture and out of the creek, we would have a fence in place. A controlled stream crossing practice can provide the animals with a specific place to either cross the creek or have access for drinking water. Such a stream crossing allows the animals to get into the creek for water, but does not provide room for lounging. You also notice in the picture and on the model that the crossing is located in a sunny area. This placement allows animals to have access to water, but further encourages them to get back away from the water to find shade. The movement away from the water reduces the potential of the animals urinating or defecating in the water. We could even have them totally fenced out of the creek, and in some instances use a solar powered pump to pump water up to them out of the creek. That would allow them to have water shade and not need access to the pond or creek itself. You would then have them corralled in a whole corral, as you see here. That concludes our look at the agricultural section of the Enviroscape watershed model. If you have questions on the BMP shown or questions about water quality, please contact your local extension agents, NRCS, or the Soil and Water Conservation District. Thank you.